Here we are for the second lecture. So today we are gonna start with some terminology and some notions that are gonna be crucial in the following. So we're starting like to go in the heart of the story, let's say. So I hope that yesterday I convinced you that we need, we want to work in the singular case, and the reference form is not going to be Keller anymore. So here we take, so little by little, okay? So theta is a 1-1 form. So a smooth form, real. So theta bar equal to theta. Closed, meaning declosed, and in particular, theta defines a cohomology class in the H11 of X with real coefficients, but we don't ask any positivity condition for the moment, okay? So you take any smooth 1-1 form, real and closed, and then you say that a function U on X, so sorry, maybe I should say it again. I mean, this is always X is gonna be a compact Keller manifold, a complex dimensional compact Keller. This is always the same assumption. So a function on X, real valued, that I can also take the minus infinity value, is quasi pluri subharmonic, so quasi pluri subharmonic, and this is QPSH for short. Let me see. If U can be locally written, so this is locally as a smooth function plus a pluri subharmonic function. So maybe if U is an integrable function and U can be written as a smooth one plus a pluri subharmonic one. So PSH of a pluri subharmonic, where pluri subharmonic means that it's subharmonic on each complex line. Okay, so quasi pluri subharmonic is a local, so let's say it requires a local condition. And now we say, so this is quasi pluri subharmonic, we say that this function U is theta pluri subharmonic, so the quasi is replaced by theta, quasi theta pluri subharmonic, and this is going to be theta PSH for short. If U is quasi PSH, quasi pluri subharmonic, and moreover, we ask a global condition, so we ask that theta plus I did bar of U is positive in the weak sense of currents. So this is the weak sense. So why do I say weak sense? Because here I'm assuming that U is a function that can be singular somewhere, can take the minus infinity value. So a priori U is not C2, hence we cannot take the classical derivatives. We need to take the distributional derivatives. And this is why I'm asking that this inequality has to look in the weak sense. So what does it mean, this condition? Let me rewrite it. So this is the bar. So this condition here is a star. Let's actually is equivalent to say that I did the bar of U is greater or equal than minus theta. So actually, in some sense, we are saying that we need to bound by theta. We have a lower bound given by theta, by minus theta, of the distributional relation of U. Okay. So it's a bound of the action of U somehow. Okay, so maybe examples of such functions that you can keep in mind.
So for example, let's start with the easy case. So let's now take theta equal to omega equal a caret form. This is gonna be our baby case, just to understand like how things work. It's a good case to keep in mind. Then for example, in this case, you can take any C2 function, take u, that is C2 on x, and then I claimed that there exists a constant big enough such that a omega plus I dd bar of u is greater or equal to zero. So why is that? Yeah, because this is equivalent to say that I dd bar of u is bounded below by minus a times omega. But so u is a C2 function, so this guy here is a continuous, so it makes sense to do the second derivative, the classical second derivatives, and we are saying that we are gonna bound, this is a matrix of continuous function, and we are saying that we are bounded that by a large constant. So this is okay. Okay, so what does it say? Let me rewrite down this condition. This is equivalent to say the omega plus I did the bar of u divided by a is greater or equal to zero. I didn't do nothing except of dividing by a, everything. And so this means that given a C2 function, then u divided by a is omega vs h. So this is what we just proved, right? So this is just to give you a lot of examples of omega vs h function. But then these are like the smooth ones, the regular ones. As I said, a priori quasi Purius Borbonic function, or in a more particularly theta PSH function, are allowed to be singular. So let's see like the examples for the singular case. You can take, so this was example one. Example two, you can take something, so this can be an exercise for you. You take a function that locally writes as, so let's say locally in the unit ball. So V01, the ball center is zero and of radius one. You can take log of the absolute value norm of z. So z is the local coordinates. And then you can check that this is a quasi PSH function. Or for example, so you see here, like just u goes to minus infinity when the norm of z approaches zero. So here we have an example of singular quasi Purius Borbonic function. And then you can take as well something of the type minus the log and alpha z to the power alpha, and then you need to take a minus with alpha in between 0 and 1. For any alpha in between 0 and 1, this is going to be quasi Purius Borbonic as well. And here you see that this is again singular at z equal to 0, because here you get minus infinity, this goes to plus infinity, then you raise to the power, but then you got the minus infinity on top. Okay? Another example, but that's not going to be plenty, then you understand how the singularities look like. It's going to be something of the type minus log or minus log on norm of z. So again, this goes to, do I need this? Yes. This goes to minus infinity for z equal to zero, once again. But of course, look at this. So I gave you three examples of singular quasi Purius Borbonic function, but the first one is the most singular one, right? Because here we are raising at a small power, so this is less singular than log, and log is less singular than the others. And you can keep going, you can consider log, and so on, so far, okay? And all of these are quasi Purius Borbonic, and they are less and less singular, although C singular is zero. And something that maybe you can keep in mind is that actually logarithm singularities, so this type of singularities, are the worst one that quasi Purius Borbonic functions can have. So they can be singular, but always with logarithm singularities. So this type of singularity, let's say. Hmm? Okay. Where is now? Where is the reader? Okay. Good, so we have some examples to keep in mind, and maybe, so let me erase here, I'm gonna denote this set of theta Brunius Ugarmonic function with E as stage of x of theta, okay? So this is the set of theta Brunius Ugarmonic functions. So let me just like very, very quickly recall some properties of the this function. For those of you who were there for Van Zandt's course, already saw this. So I'm just gonna do a brief recap of some of the some of the properties that we are gonna need. So for example, if A of theta VSH functions, if U is a theta VSH function, then actually U is in LP with respect to a volume form, let's say dV, the Lebesgue form, for any P positive. So they're integrable they are in any LP. And actually, so being integrable is a local property. So actually, the integrability property is just a consequence of the integrability properties of Lewis Ubermonic functions. Mm? This is a consequence of the integrability property of the subharmonic functions. So just something of a local property. Then what I can say for this something that one should keep in mind, but actually just like it's hidden in the definition, is that a TW subharmonic function is U, theta Brunius Ugarmonic function, is upper semi-continuous. So upper semi-continuous, meaning that, so this is the picture. So this is, so here we take this point. So this is an example of a function on upper semi-continuous function. Otherwise, the definition is that the limit, so this is A here, of x going to a, or u of x is less or equal than u of a, or equivalent that for any c real, the set of points such that u of x is less than c is open. So we are gonna use the upper semi-continuity somewhere in the following. Okay. So now we have this set of functions, theta VSH of x theta, and the first question that we would like to ask and to be assured is that this set is not empty. We want to work with this type of function on the manifold X. So we want to be sure that this space is not empty, right? Because otherwise the empty set is not really useful. So, and it turns out that this set is non-empty if and only if. So here, like we start seeing, so you can see this equivalence as a definition or an equivalence if you know the definition in the algebraic sense. So if and only if the cohomology class defined by theta is pseudo-effective, would do effective, and moreover, so already we know that there are a lot of cases such that this space is not empty. And moreover, we also have, we want the space to be not empty, but also we want to be sure that there are a lot of functions on it. Okay, so two things. And for the second condition, we say that the space is not empty. So when we subtract a little bit of positivity, this is not empty for epsilon positive, if and only if the cohomology class of theta is big. So if you there is also an algebraic definition of being big for cohomology classes, this can be your definition. So being big for a class defined by theta means that this set of functions is non-empty. But what does it mean, like this set is not empty? Okay, so let's rewrite this condition. This condition is equivalent to say that there exists a function on x, so let me call it phi k there, from x that can take real value but also the minus infinity value, such that this function is quasi plurisubharmonic with respect to this guy. So this is the definition, I'm just rewriting the definition. So such that theta minus epsilon omega plus I dd bar of this phi k is positive in this big sense. But then let's rewrite it. This means, I'm just rewriting things, that theta plus I dd bar of phi k is greater or equal, let's put the epsilon omega on the other side, is greater or equal than epsilon omega. And this type of potentials are called the Kähler potentials. So this is a Kähler current. So when you look at the level of weak forms, because this is not smooth, it's called the Kähler current. And when you look at the Kähler potential, you say a singular Kähler potential. Meaning that when you look at the associated weak form, you have this kind of thing. I mean, why Kähler current? This is the analogous of a Kähler form. So yeah, if you think of this, so this is for any positive epsilon, you are saying that this guy, even if it's singular, is somehow strictly positive, right? Because this guy is strictly positive. Yes.
Theta is big, there exists some epsilon, or for every epsilon?
If they exist.
Yeah. Okay. Awesome.
Okay. Yeah, here you fix an epsilon, and then you say that this set is empty if and only if. This is your definition, actually. Okay. So you have this. And actually, so yeah, it's like I'm not gonna prove this, but this Kähler potential has been proven by Desmahis in the 80s, I guess, that can have, you can take Kähler singular potentials or Kähler current having analytic singularities. I'm gonna write it down. So phi Kähler, so this is Desmahis. So phi Kähler, the singular potential, can be chosen to have analytic singularities, meaning that there exists a small enough, such that phi Kähler writes as C times the log of the sum of the absolute values of the norm to the power 2 of holomorphic functions plus a smooth one. Smooth function. Okay. So this potential can be chosen to have a very, very explicit and precise behavior. And in particular, a priori, we know where they are singular, right? When all the, at the intersection of all the zero locus of the FJs. When all the FJs are zero, then you have log of zero, and this goes to minus infinity. Okay. And now we are ready, we have all the ingredients to define the so-called ampus locus of theta of the cohomology class. So this is a cohomology invariant, but like like to be short, to be quick, and the following is going to be just the ample log of theta without the brackets. But remember, this is a cohomological invariant, and this is going to be the set of all the x such that there exists a phi Keller, so a Keller, a singular Keller potential, such that when I look at, let me call it T Keller, so theta plus I d bar of phi Keller, this is a smooth form, this is smooth in a neighborhood of X. So of course, so if you see these examples, of course, these the points that are like in the intersection of all the zero locus of these FJs cannot be here, right? Okay, and maybe also like a theorem, this set when theta is big, so this is always going to be our assumption, okay? This is always, for us, theta is going to be always big, and it's already enough, okay? We always assume that. We always assume this. And in this case, one can see that this is non-empty, and this is it's a risky dense. And this is a result of Muxon in 2004. We are happy. So now we define, we know what big means. So big is a cohomology class defined by a smooth one-one form, real and closed, such that there exists a singular Keller potential inside the set of TWB function. And in particular, so we say that in the set of theta plus harmonic function is not empty, and there are a lot of theta this h function. So the idea to keep in mind what we said is that theta is big, then the set this h of x theta has plenty of functions. Functions. So this is the idea to have. But then let me give you one example, one global example. So V theta, an example is V theta, defined as the sum of all the U theta plurisub harmonic functions, such that U is less or equal than zero. So yeah, what we are doing, we are considering all the theta plus harmonic function that are below a barrier. So this is a barrier function. And then we are taking the soup. So taking the soup is something that is gonna preserve the quasi plurisub harmonicity, but We need to ensure that the function is upper semi-continuous. Otherwise, taking the soup could jump in the wrong way. So we just need to take the upper semi-continuous regularization to have the property. But one can, so let me take, so this is with the star. But one can actually prove, so claim, you can do that as an exercise, but it's super easy, that the upper semi-continuous regularization of V theta is equal to V theta itself, because the upper semi-continuous regularization is going to be still a candidate in the soup. So a priori, this is what we know, because the upper semi-continuous continuous regularization is greater by definition of taking the upper semi-continuous regularization, but also V theta star is a candidate in the envelope because it's theta plus h and less equal to zero. It's a candidate of the of in the envelope. And this means that V theta star is less or equal to V theta. Okay? So here we just we can not take this. The star is gonna be the same. Okay, so this is like the first example. We are gonna see this procedure of constructing theta of Lorentz superharmonic function as the envelope, as the soup of a family. So remember this type of construction, but let's make like an example, okay? Example, the baby, again, our baby example, when theta is omega is equal k there. So in this case, we have that V of omega, so let's rewrite the guy down, is the soup of what? Of U omega psh functions, such that U is less or equal than zero. Okay, and now my question is, maybe for you in the audience, except for Stefano, what V theta is? So what's the supremum of all the omega psh function that are bounded by zero? So like observation for you, zero in this case is the function zero, identity equal to zero, is omega psh, right? Because omega plus idd bar of zero is equal to omega that is positive. So zero is omega psh, is also less or equal than zero. So zero is a candidate in the envelope. So a priori, this tells me that zero is less or equal than V theta. But V theta is always bounded by zero, by definition. So we have also the other inequality. So V theta is equal to zero. Okay? So this is just zero. So this is just to tell you that this guy here, as we're gonna see in a moment, really is the best guy ever in the set of omega psh functions, okay? So it's really like the nice guy. In the case of the Keller form, it just at the level, it just like it's a Keller potential. It's a smooth guy, and then it's a nice one. Okay, yes, I can still go for a little bit. So we have this function V theta, and I'm gonna construct some functions using this envelope construction. But before, I really would like to prove you that this V theta is really the best function. Okay, so this is the idea that I want to now kind of prove. So V theta is the best theta VSH function. So fixing theta V theta is kind of the best, and we are gonna see what best means, okay? So in order to do that, to convince you of this kind of a very sloppy statement, I'm gonna start giving you some notions, some other terminology. So here we say that we are working with this theta Lorentz harmonic function, and we have plenty of them. So now we would like to see if sometimes we say that this function a priori are singular, that goes at minus infinity. You remember log, 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 blah, blah, blah. And then the question is, can we somehow compare them? At least sometimes. And the answer is yes. And how do we do that? Well, we say that, so this is the definition. We say that given two theta VSH function, U and V, that U is more singular than V. So let me say here, given U and V in the set. So this is the definition, okay? We say the U is more singular than V. Let me write it down here, more singular if there exists a positive constant such that U is less or equal than V plus a constant. And then we say that U has the same singularity than V, so the little wave here means same singularity. If there exists a constant, so if, let me say two things, if U is more singular than V and V is more singular than U, so as you can imagine, we have both inequality, let's say, and this means that just by definition that there exists again a constant such that when we look at the difference of these two functions, the difference is bounded. Okay, so now observations. First of all, this is a partial order on the set of TW supermodic functions, so partial order. Only partial, okay? Why? Because a priori we cannot. So what does it mean that this having the U is more singular than V? It means that U goes a minus infinity faster than V, right? This is what it means. But a priori, so it's partial because we cannot always compare the singularities. So let me write it down in an example. So we cannot always compare the singularities, and I'm gonna give you two examples. So an example, the singularities. So you take, I don't know, in so let's be locally. So in C2, you have in P2, so a coordinate chart of P2, let's say C2, and then you consider U, that is the log of the absolute values of Z1, the first coordinate, and B, that is the log of the second coordinate, Z2. Both of them goes to minus infinity when on the U on the divisor Z1 equal to zero, and B when Z2 is equal to zero, right? But we cannot say that one goes faster faster to minus infinity than the other, because they are singular at different sets. I mean, except for zero. Okay, so we can always compare, and this is just a partial order. And this is gonna be like exercise for you, but this is kind of straightforward. This here, this relation is an equivalence relation. So is the equivalence. Equivalence relation, because if U is say that's the same singularity than V, then V has the same singularity than U. If U, V, and U has the same singularities of V, and V has the same singularities of W, then U has the same singularity of W, so and so on. So this is an equivalence relation, and in particular, I'm gonna define, so I can define a class, the class of singularity that I denoted by U. So in this, I'm gonna take all the V, all the TWSH functions, such that V has the same singularity of U. And this is called singularity type. Okay? Okay, so now that we have these notions, we are ready to understand why this V theta is the best candidate. Or in particular now, my claim is that V theta, so the claim that now we are ready to prove, the claim is that V theta has minimal singularities, meaning that for any u given any theta pluri subharmonic function, then we have that u is more singular than v theta. So v theta is less singular than any other theta pluri subharmonic function, any function in the set. Okay, so this is why it's the best candidate. Okay, how do we prove that?
This is kind of easy, because so by definition of v theta,
by definition we see that that by definition, so we start observing that u, so we take u at theta pluri subharmonic function, then u minus the sup over x of u, this is again a theta pluri subharmonic function, because this is a constant, and is also bounded by zero, right? Because it's u minus the sup. So u minus the sup is a candidate in the definition of v theta, and this means that u minus the sup over x of u is less or equal than v theta. So what we prove that u is less or equal than v theta plus the sup of u, and we call this c. Okay? Are you happy? Can you see there or not really? No, so maybe I couldn't. So let me see. Can you see it up to here or not? Okay, just for the but you can see here, right?
Yes.
Okay, so maybe I'm gonna rewrite it down twice, the same thing. So in the part that you cannot see, I just put the soup on the other side. Okay, so v theta has minimal singularity, meaning that is less singular than any other theta pluri subharmonic function. And actually, using this, we can now also say, we can also prove, let me go here, we can also prove that v theta is locally bounded. I mean, we have all the ingredients to do that. This is wonderful. So let me do claim two. I mean, this v theta is gonna appear a lot of times, so it's important that you keep in mind all the power and beauty of this function. So the claim two is that v theta is also locally bounded. Where? Locally bounded on the ampus locus of theta. So why is that? Well, so proof, because we say that v theta is less singular than any other theta pluri subharmonic function, right? So in particular, p theta is less singular than the singular Kähler potential with analytic singularities that I defined before. This was the singular Kähler potential. Kähler potential with analytic singularities. And this guy, by the fact that, just by definition of the ampus locus, is locally bounded, it's moved on the ampus locus, right? This guy here, by definition, is smooth on the ampus.
You can choose for every point of the ampus locus.
Yes. So let's say it's smooth. In a neighbor. So fix x on the ampus locus if you want, but then you can take any point of the ampus locus. and then it's going to be less VT, that's going to be less singular than the carrier potential that is moved in a neighborhood of X. And in particular, this means that V theta is going to be bounded in a neighborhood of X. So V theta is bounded in a neighborhood of X. That was in the Ampus locus. So if you do that for any point of the Ampus locus, you get that V theta is locally bounded on the, all the Ampus locus. I mean, this is something that I wanted to prove, that because it's kind of quite straightforward once we have all these ingredients. But then actually, so you see that guy, this V theta, and then someone is gonna tell you, ah, you know what? This is locally bounded on a Zariski dense subset. Really? Why? Actually, it's not so complicated. And moreover, as we are going to see, this guy encodes a lot of information on the class theta. So it really is special. Okay. So we have this V theta that was constructed with this envelope construction. And as promised, now I'm gonna give you other, so we say that this was already, we didn't need to take the upper semi-continuous parabolization. This was just an example, and I'm gonna give you more. So as I said, this zero here is the barrier, okay? So you should think of this as f, the barrier f equal to zero, but then you can also think to take f, any lower semi-continuous function, L is for lower. Continuous, and then you could define the envelope of F of this barrier as, so this is again a definition, the supremum of all the theta fluid subharmonic functions that now are bounded by F, not zero anymore. Okay? So sometimes when one can be confused, here you put a theta, to make sure that you are considering the quasi-pluri subharmonic function with respect to the fixed reference form. But when there is no confusion can arise, you can drop this theta. So using this kind of terminology, you see that this envelope here, this V theta, is nothing else than the envelope of zero, right? Just another way of writing things. So yeah, for any lower semi-continuous function, you got something, this, that is here. One can prove that it is either identically minus infinity, because maybe f is too singular, it's very bad, or otherwise, if it's not identical minus infinity, it belongs again to the set of theta sh functions. So plenty of examples. And maybe one observation slash remark, just to start really playing with things. Observation. So now assume, for example, that F is bounded. Okay, F is bounded, then actually PF, the envelope of F, has the same singularity of V theta. So this means that the singularity type, when I look at the class, this class, the singularity type is equal to the singularity type of V theta. I mean, this is just a reformulation. It was just a definition, right? Because having the same singularity, it means that I am in the same class. So this was just a means, and let's see why, okay? So why is that? F is bounded, so it means that F is in between C and minus C. So here this P, I mean, I don't know if you, I should check, but maybe yes. So P, if you look at U, that is theta sh and less than F, then u is less than c, and this means the u minus c is less or equal than zero. So here you are saying that u minus c is less or equal than b theta, right? Because this is going to be theta plus h is less than zero, so it means that this in the envelope and is less or equal than b theta. And taking the supremum over all the u in this envelope here, so you take the supremum over u, you get that p of f minus c is less or equal to zero. With the same game at the other side, using minus c, you got the reverse inequality. Okay?
B theta, not that zero.
Yes, yes, V theta, yeah, sure. Mm-hmm. From here to here. The reverse inequality is the same. I mean, similar. Are you okay? Yeah, if you can all read something, you can tell me.
No, I am. Yeah, I'm convinced.
Yeah? You are convinced? Good. And then you can do the same game with Mansi. Okay. This is just like we are going forward, because I'm going to define something else, and maybe I can take a 5 minutes break. We are going towards the idea that now, you see, so even if f is not zero, so f zero is very nice, is smooth, and blah, 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 f is just, even if f is just bounded, but not necessarily smooth, then you are in the same singularity class. So you have the same behavior minus infinity, but this is very understandable, right? Because if a function is bounded, then it doesn't go to minus infinity, then you are okay. So being the same class, it means that the difference is bounded, not necessarily smooth. So this is why bounded is the right notion to consider. Okay, and now last example of TW superharmonic functions constructed with this envelope. Construction is, last two examples, let's say. So for example, you can take F. This is a very special case. When you take F being the minimum between U and V, where U and V are any two theta plurisuperharmonic functions. This can be proved to be lower semi-continuous, and then the envelope in this special case is denoted, I denoted and generally denoted with P of U and V. So this means the envelope where the barrier is the minimum of the two. This is just a notation, okay? We are going to use this notation in the following, in this special case. And this the last example of, so here was the first example. So maybe 1, 2, and then 3, the last example of TW is harmonic function constructed with the envelope, is what is called the envelope, the so-called envelope of singularity. So I take U and B. So these are two TW superharmonic functions, as before. And this is defined as, so let's see what we do. First of all, we do the envelope. We do the envelope of the minimum in between U plus C, a constant, a positive constant, and V. And now we take C, that goes to plus infinity. Take the limit for C that goes to plus infinity. So this was the envelope of the minimum between these two. And then I take the limit for C that goes to plus infinity. And then just to be sure, I'm going to take the upper semi-continuous regularization. And again, this guy either is identical equal to minus infinity or is a theta plurisuperharmonic function. The same over here. But let me just observe something before the quick break, the 5 minutes break. So here in this case, observe that if U is bounded, So let's say that if U of X is bounded, so if U is bounded in the neighborhood of X, for example, so bounded minus B, okay, then there exists C big enough, because here we are taking the limit for C that goes to plus infinity, there exists C big enough such that the minimum in between U plus C and V is going to be equal to V, right? Because C is very, very, very big, it's going to be to plus infinity, and the minimum is going to be V, the other one, right? It's just the minimum of plus infinity versus something. Can you see here? Not really, right? So let me find the idea. So if U is bounded at a point, then for C big enough, the minimum of U plus C and V is equal to V. Huh? But if U goes to minus infinity, then minus infinity plus any constant is going to be minus infinity, right? So really the minimum is going to be determined by U. This is why this is called the envelope of singularities of U, because really it depends on the singularity type of the function. Envelope of singularity of U. So here, this is, let me just write it here. This is called, this is a name, okay? Envelope of singularity.
So if you keep U and change V, what happens? Maybe.
If you keep, you mean how do they change?
So you say that the Simpsons.
You keep U and you change V.
Yes.
Maybe I'm
in
gonna
some
say.
Way then if this does depend only some philosophically only on U. Should this be not exactly?
So this is kind of a spoiler. Maybe let me write it down. This is gonna be also clear in my mind if this is what you wanna know. So spoiler, I'm gonna be more precise later on. So for example, you can see that P of U of B. So let's assume, so if you want here V, you're taking V less singular than U.
Okay.
And then this is gonna be equal to V if and only if U is in the, so this is just for to answer Stefano's question, I'm gonna be more precise in a moment, in the full class with respect to V.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so here you can take any, I mean, if you take any U in this class, then this envelope is gonna always be the same.
Okay.
This V, I mean, then it's gonna change if you change V, but then you have to be in this class. This answer partially, maybe.
Partially.
Yeah.
It was more philosophical, because,
More
philosophical.
I understand the question. I have to think maybe carefully about that. But I understand. So your point was, you fix U and you let B change. What has happened, right?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I'm gonna think about that. Okay. So quick historic remark. This envelope was actually introduced very recently in a paper of Ross and Wittenstrom in 2018. I mean, it has a long history because envelopes are studied since the 70s in pluripotential theory for domains of CN as well. So, but this very specific construction was given by Ross and Wittenstrom. Yes, if you have questions, don't hesitate. Okay, so this is very particular construction. Okay, maybe we can take just a small break to breathe, and then I'm gonna start again.
Okay.
Yes. Okay.
Excuse me. What was P of U V.
This? This?
You're no. taking the limit of something?
Yes, I'm taking the limit over the when C goes to plus infinity on the envelope of U plus C and V, and this was by definition the envelope of the minimum of U plus C and V.
Oh, okay.
So, I mean, I can rewrite it down here, okay? So this is the minimum of U plus C and V. Okay, is that better?
Yes,
so it was just a notation.
Yes, it's above.
Is it okay?
Okay.
No, I mean, like, ask questions, huh? I'm here for this.
Because okay. that guy is increasing in C, so that limit.
Yes, yes. I'm, this is a good. I mean, I am gonna use this observation. I can observation. Since we are talking, this guy, the envelope of U plus C and V. So you can call it UC if you want. I don't know. Let's call it just. So it's a sequence depending on C, and this is increasing in C. It's a sequence of functions. Of theta plurisible harmonic function and is increasing of C. We are gonna use this. This is important. I mean, that is increasing of C just by definition of the envelope. It's gonna be used later. Okay.
Or fixed U and V.
Yeah, sure. I fixed U and V theta stage, and then I define this V, V, you can take V less singular than U. And then this sequence here is increasing in C. And this also, is also why the limit exists.
It's also smaller than V, so that doesn't blow up.
Oh, of course, right. Of course. This is increasing in C, and again by definition is less or equal than V. So the limit exists because it's bounded from above and the sequence is increasing.
So how about the interchange energy?
Say?
By the symmetry of the operator envelope.
Like no, no, it's not. It sounds. I mean, here you're taking V less singular than U.
Okay.
So you cannot reverse.
Oh yeah, so this is an assumption.
Yeah.
You always assume.
Always assume this thing. And maybe last thing, this is a notation. When V is equal to V theta, so maybe two of, this is, okay, this is maybe first an observation and then a notation. This is observation one, observation two. This can be another exercise. P of U of V of F. If you take any F, this is just P of U, any local semi-continuous function of P of F. So inside of here, you can take is theta plurisable harmonic function associated or just the function. In a sense, and the notation, this is a notation I'm gonna use later on, where you take U of V theta, that was that thanks to observation 2 is equal to P of U of 0. This is just noted, denoted by P of brackets U. Okay? So when you see P of brackets U, it means that the V is V theta, the special guy. So for the special guy, and the special guy is always less singular than any other thing. So we are in good shape. Okay? Okay. So Stefan, in this 5 minutes, so let's take, I don't know, 3 minutes break. I don't know if you want to make a break or not.
Sure.
Yeah?
Sure.
And I can check just the drop of things.
Okay.
I mean, and then if you're tired, if you want to see more examples or whatever, you can stop me, huh? It can be even more interactive. Stefan, tu no, non puoi.
No.
Sì, poi. Poi. Ah.
Ah, ok. Ho scritto Giorgio Chiarati.
Ah.
Tutto chiaro. Adesso ti scelgo, eh? Allora ce l'hai coso?
Alle 5, 3, 5, 5 e mezza, non mi ricordo.
No, ok.
Ma a Civitta ce l'ho, mi pare.
Vabbè, magari devi stare un po' prima.
Sì, sì, certo.
So, would you at some point discuss the notion of NAP effective for comedy class?
No, but if you want, I can tell you.
Yes, because I'm curious. So.
Yeah, I can tell you.
Is it effective or NAP?
Effective is the effective in the analytic world is pseudo-effective. So effective is for a divisor or a class.
Okay.
So this is the analog was pseudo-effective. What I told you at the beginning, the cohomology class is pseudo-effective if and only if the theta plurisubharmonic function, the set, is not empty, you remember?
Yes.
Wait,
what does it mean? Okay, so you define pseudo effective as.
So effective and NAP is the following.
Yes.
So let me rewrite down. So just to, because there are several point of views, so let me also unify everything. So this was our, let's say, definition or equivalence with the algebraic geometric world. So theta is self-effective. Set. And what does it mean? So what does it mean this? This means that there exists, let's say, phi, theta psh, such that theta plus I dv bar of phi is less or equal than zero, right?
Yes. Positive.
Yeah.
Yeah. You say less than.
No, you said. I said. You said smaller, less.
Ah, sorry. No, greater or equal. Greater or equal than zero. And phi can be singular. Okay.
Yes.
Can be singular. So this is self-effective. Then we say big. We say that theta is big. If and only if, this is already we said, there exists a Keller singular potential such that theta plus I dv bar of phi Keller is greater or equal than epsilon omega, right? So there exists an epsilon. Now theta is big, is left. Sorry, it's not if and only if for any epsilon, for any the cohomology class theta plus epsilon omega when omega is Keller is a Keller class. Is a Keller class. What does it mean being a Keller class? It means so EA, there exists. Omega epsilon, let me call it, in this class, that is a Keller form. Keller form. But what does it mean? It means that there exists phi epsilon such that omega epsilon is equal to theta plus epsilon omega plus I dv bar of phi epsilon, and this is Keller. So phi epsilon is moot now. Okay. Okay, these are all the. Are you happy?
Yes.
Okay, good. So again, here the guy can be singular, here the guy is singular, here the guy is gonna be smooth.
So the big condition is stronger than just saying theta plus I dv bar fitted color is strictly positive.
No, in the sense, it doesn't make sense for currents to be strictly positive. Okay. You cannot say that a current, you have like
you can say strongly positive. There is a notion of strongly positive for currents, but then it's different from this. So for currents it's different, but even because for forms,
yes,
there is a notion of being positive and strongly positive, yes, for forms, differential forms. And for forms of any degree, PP, okay? Then the definition of being positive for currents is dual to the one of forms. So being positive for a current, for a singular object like this, it means when I come si dice scontrare?
I apply
that to a strongly positive form, then I got something that is greater or equal to zero. Okay? But then there is no notion of like being strictly positive. This is what I say. And this is kind of, this is like the alternative notion to be strictly positive. So, because this makes sense, it means that then when you do that, this is greater or equal to zero. Okay? Did I answer to your question? Okay. I want just to check. Come l'hai chiamato? No.
Ele
Keller? No.
No, Ele Keller è la. No, no, sul Dropbox Eleonora qualcosa.
Corso Eleonora.
Esatto.
Sì.
Arrivato, perfetto.
Yes.
Ottimo.
Ok. I can go on.
Aspetta, magari.
Sì.
Proviamo altri due minuti.
Di che?
Che mi dici che succede, per esempio, quando c'è la prossima lezione, per esempio.
Ah, ok, sì.
Così magari preparo.
Avevo detto lo studio da qualche parte. Beh, il lunedì, come avevo detto, lunedì 10 gennaio 14:30 16 va benissimo.
Va bene, ti piace?
Sì, va benissimo. Ok, vado? Ok, so now, in the last, let's say 15 minutes, even 20, maybe Stefano can go. But
okay.
I would like, actually this is something nice that I'm gonna do. I usually don't do that in any of my talks, but this is not a talk, so I can prove something as well, I mean, as I did. What we are gonna do is that I said that the geometric motivation of all this stuff was to solve motion pair equations with prescribed singularities, right? So we needed to define what is the motion pair measure of these singular functions. So for now we defined what the TW Hilbert-Monic function is. We saw that it can be also singular, it can have singularity at minus infinity. Then we construct a lot of examples where we are gonna use in the following. And now we're gonna wanna define what is the wedge n times of this guy, this singular guy. Okay? So this is what I'm gonna do. Okay, so now I take U, any theta blue is supermodic function. So here now we are in this very general setting of the big classes, okay? Theta is always big, always divided in a big cohomology class. We take U, and then what we want to define, so the question is how to define theta plus I to the bar of u to the power n. Okay? So what's the problem? We would like this guy, as in Yau's theorem, in a bound Yau's theorem, we would like to define it to be a positive measure, not negative, okay? not necessarily a smooth measure, a boring flow, huh? Still a measure, Radon measure. So how to do this? And so first of all, what's the problem? The problem is that in the smooth case, how do we do? So let's say if U is smooth, let's assume if U is smooth, then it's okay. Why? Because theta plus I d bar of U to the power n is just, so let me call it this guy to be short. Also the formula is gonna be theta of U. So when you see theta of U is theta plus I d bar of U, is all this guy, huh? The current. So this guy is just theta of U, wedge theta of U, wedge blah blah blah, wedge theta of U n times, right? So you do the wedge product of forms n times, and then you're happy. This is if U is smooth. But as we said, we want to go towards singular functions. So let's go further. So let's assume that now U is bounded. If U is bounded, so this was a check, this is okay, because thanks to Beffer and Taylor theory, in the 80s. So the third case is gonna be U singular, if U is singular. So I'm gonna come back on this setting, because this last setting, that is what is gonna be of interest for us, it relies on the case of the bounded case, so the definition of this measure for bounded function, and this is what I'm gonna do. So I don't know if you know the construction actually. I don't know. Do you know it?
No, probably.
I mean, I'm not gonna do all the details, but I thought it was a good thing to do. Okay, so let's do this. Okay. So this is something that actually one can do locally. So let's try to look locally, okay? So U, we say that is a theta reducible bounded function and bounded.
Yes, I know some.
You know. So U is bounded, so and is theta PSH. So for example, how you go from the global to the local. So U is global, is theta PSH. But then, for example, if you are in a local chart, so let's assume that you are in a local chart, and then the form theta, you can write it as IDD bar of rho locally. So why is that? Because locally in a coordinable, the cohomology is trivial, so the cohomology class of theta is locally trivial, hence, thanks to the Debye-Bar lemma, we can write it as IDD bar of something. So this, because this is equivalent to be the exact. Okay, so we write the form like this, and the condition of being theta PSH, meaning that theta plus IDD bar of U is positive, then is equivalent to asking that IDD bar of rho plus IDD bar of U is positive, and this is equivalent to say that IDD bar of rho plus U is positive. And then maybe Laura already recognized this. This means that rho plus U, this is PSH locally. It's plurisubharmonic locally. This is now a local function. This means that rho plus U, that I'm gonna call U tilde, is plurisubharmonic. So plurisubharmonic really just means that when I look at the distributional action, then I got something positive, okay? So this is the definition. Definition of being PSH. Okay, so now we have something local, U tilde. So now U tilde is defined on a ball. Whatever you want, so it's a 0, 1, it's bounded because rho is smooth, okay? Rho is smooth because theta is smooth. Bounded and so U theta is bounded and PSH. So again, we know that IDD bar of U is positive. So I d bar of u tilde is okay, is positive. And then now we want to define, and we say that this is what we want to define. Okay, this is the question. If we know how to define this, we know how to define theta plus I d bar to the power n. This is just the local version, but it's the same. Okay, how do we do? So we take u tilde. We take u tilde, we do I d bar, and this we can do. This is going to be a current, so something like we did the distribution of the derivatives. So a priori, we are allowed to multiply currents, the singular guys, by bounded functions. This we can do. We can multiply just because u tilde is bounded. If u tilde was minus infinity somewhere, we cannot do that. There is no way. So. Warning, we can multiply only because u tilde is bounded. We can multiply because u tilde is bounded. Otherwise, we couldn't do that. Okay, so now we can multiply. We can we have a new current. It's just u tilde times I d bar of u tilde. And now we do the again, we do the I d bar of this. And this, so we can always do this, this is just the derivative in the distributional sense. This is by definition, this for our definition is I to the power of u tilde to the power 2. This is our definition, this is gonna be okay. And if you assume that u tilde is smooth, so everything is gonna be coherent. You get exactly the same thing. Okay? So this is like the definition of the power 2. But then we want to go up, right? We want to go up to power n. So we iterate the thing.
No, aspetta, scusa, però. Sei sicuro che non c'è un pieno delta quadro, delta bar quadro, che fa zero, aspetta.
Because this will be, so let's assume, let's do the also for me. Let's assume that u tilde is smooth.
Okay. Huh?
Then we can just to see if everything goes well. So and you do this, right? So you do I d, and here you have d bar of u tilde wedge I d d bar of u tilde. Then you get plus u delta bar wedge d bar d bar u tilde, and this is zero.
Okay.
Right. And then now you have to do this, and this is I d d bar u tilde wedge I d d bar u tilde, and this is exactly the guy that we want. And the other guy would be minus, because this is a 0, 1, 0, 4, minus I d u tilde wedge I d square d bar square u tilde, and this is zero. You know these rules that d bar is antisymmetric, so it's equal to minus d bar d, and when you have d square or d bar square, this is zero. These are it comes from the Derham cohomology. You happy?
Yes.
Okay. So it was okay. So we can do that, and now we iterate. Okay. So we iterate this process if you want. And then what we do, so let me take some space. Let me take some space, and then I say that I d d bar of u tilde to the power n, this is equal to what? So you take I d d bar of what? So it's gonna be of u tilde of I d d bar of u n minus 1. I mean, it's just an iterative construction. Huh? So you can define this guy, then you multiply this guy for u tilde, you can do because u tilde is bounded, you take I d d bar, you define I d d bar to the power 3, and so far, so on. And then at the end of the day, you define this guy.
Tilde,
yes, sure. Okay? So this is our definition. And everything goes well. So now, really, last 5 minutes, because as I say, now we are here. We did this step. I mean, this is like a long story short, okay? But just to give you what was the strategy. So but now we still need to prove this to see what happens in the singular case. So I'm just going to give you how the definition goes, and then we are going to come back to that next year. So if U is singular, then the emotional pair, this guy here, is defined. There is a way to define it, and it was defined by, so I'm going to say that, and then I'm going to write Buxom SCD Gesh Ezeriai. So B-E-G-Z, and is in a paper in ACTA in 2010. So actually this is kind of a foundational work, let's say, for this kind of thing. Okay, and how do we do that? So as I said, this last case, that one can allow singularities, is built on the case of bounded function. So let's try to just to see what happens in the singular case. Huh? So if U is singular, then what we do is we define like a sequence UJ, so this is definition, is gonna be in the maximum in between U and V theta minus J. So V theta was the very special guy. So the J, this is a sequence of function that is decreasing decreasing to U when J goes to plus infinity, right? Because when J goes to plus infinity, it goes to minus infinity, and the minimum is U. Mm-hmm. Okay? So this is decreasing to U, but the observation is now that, so the maximum between, so the maximum between U and V theta minus J, UJ, is still a theta plurie supermonic function, because the maximum in between two theta plurie supermonic function is still theta sh. So theta sh function are stable under the max construction, as it should be. So it's theta sh and UJ by construction, since it's the maximum, is greater or equal than V theta minus J, right? I mean, I didn't say anything. I mean, I reformulated the definition. But what does it mean? It means that for any J, for any fixed J, UJ is locally bounded on the Anclus locus that I'm going to call capital omega, okay? Just to. When you say capital omega, is the Anclus locus, is this Zariski open subset. So this is because V theta was locally bounded on the Anclus locus. But then if UJ is greater or equal than V theta, then we have the same assumption for UJ. So now UJ is locally bounded on omega, and it means that when we restrict on omega, we can define the emotion pair of UJ using Beckford-Taylor. Huh? So Beckford-Taylor is going to be BT tells me that when I restrict on omega, so I do the characteristic function of omega, of theta plus I dd bar of uj to the power n, this is okay. Right? This I can define. And then, so this is gonna be like the claim that is gonna be proved next time. So this is okay, but now we have somehow to pass to the limit, right? Because we want to define the motion pair of U, not UJ. And now what we do is we define mu J is gonna be the measure defined as the characteristic of function, but then I also cut off another set. So it's gonna be the set of U greater than V theta or equal than V theta minus J. So it's going to be a set on X. So I look at the characteristic function of this, and then times theta plus I dd bar of uj to the power n. Okay? I look at this measure. So this is not the same of that, because I'm cutting something else. So this is smaller. And the claim is, so this is well defined for a Taylor. This is okay. And the claim that the limit of mu j that goes to plus infinity exist, and it is a non-negative Radon measure. That is called the non-pluripolar. So this is a name, non-pluripolar Mohs-Ampère measure of U. And then, so this guy here, by definition, this limit is going to be the Mohs-Ampère measure of U, that is theta plus I to the power of U to the power n, by definition. I mean, the way that we used to define this guy is exactly as the limit of this non-negative measure, mu j. Mm? And the claim says that this limit exists, okay? And this is what we are gonna prove. So actually, what we are gonna prove is that this limit of measures is increasing and with bounded volume, and this is how we know that the limit exists. Again, when you have a sequence of something that is increasing and bounded from above, then the limit exists. Okay. Okay, I think I can stop here. Thanks a lot for your attention, and then see you next year. Or tomorrow.
Next year.
Next year. Are there any questions from the Zoom audience? Andrew, hey.
No, nothing, that was fine.
Yeah, okay, even if you have questions, then you can email me or whatever, okay? Excellent. And if you are on Zoom, feel free to interrupt, in general, okay.
Bye.
Ciao.
Ciao.
Happy Christmas and Happy New Year.
You all, Andrew.
You all.
Ciao.
Ciao, bye.
Bye.
Io scappo.
Tu scappi? Va bene. Vabbè, ci keep in touch noi. Noi ci keep in touch.
Keep in chat molto bene.
Tutto mai non ci sei, Stefano?
Non lo so, nel senso che siccome oggi faccio una dose, forse domani lo sto un po' tranquillo, da definire.
Vabbè, fammi sapere, non
devo sapere. Ah già, scusa, te l'ho rubata.
Che azzurra, mi piace.
Hai ragione, no, c'hai ragione.
Ah, ma quindi capo, quindi poi tu mi metti pure...